First, we have to say that prices are coming off a very low base. So basically, they hit the low as equity markets also around the turn of the year. So if you measure the year-to-date performance, obviously it looks good. And it's the old story about supply disruptions. We have Venezuela, we have Libya, and most importantly, we have Iran.
Still, the geopolitical tensions dominating the agenda. So for how long do you see this kind of small, tiny bull run continue?
That's a good question. I mean, a lot depends also on the mood in the market. And I think that's something we see today.
How would you describe the mood in the market right now?
It's bullish again. Mm-hmm. So if we look at the positioning in the US futures market, it's very bullish again. So quite some similarities to last year before prices came down.
Maybe a tiny bit too bullish, would you say, even?
Maybe not yet. So we're not on these excessively bullish levels as we had last year, so there's some more room to run, probably based on the Iran story, on the removal of the waivers. But as we see today, a call from President Trump to the OPEC is sufficient to bring prices down by 3.5%.
Any tweet, right? And also, you have tweeted on the oil prices as well. So where do you see Brent crude heading towards the end of this year?
Lower than it is today, so around 70, a little bit lower than that. But most importantly, we see the global economy weakening in 2020, which of course does not bode well for oil demand and thus prices.
So right now we have Brent crude hovering around $75 per barrel. So you would say it will stay in the range of 70 to 75 by year end 2019?
Yeah, a little bit lower than that.
Well, early this month here, you told me on this program that oil prices will actually ease and calm down. So your outlook is also a bit volatile.
No. It's basically the same outlook. So when we look into 2020 and when we put into perspective the global slowdown we are seeing originating in the States, we are still very confident that prices move back into the 60s.
But with the supply disruptions and the geopolitical tensions, we will definitely see much more market volatility for sure.
Well, it's a question of who reacts how fast. Because if we take the situation as it is today, with a likely further decline in Iranian oil exports, most likely the petronations under the lead of Saudi Arabia will react and they will increase production. So it is always a question of who reacts when to what, because also the U.S. shale industry at these levels, of course, is very keen on increasing production again.
Now, if we talk about Iran, Carsten, China, of course, is the biggest buyer of Iranian oil in the world.
Yep.
So given that they are not very happy with the U.S. Sanctions on Iran, how tense can the situation get?
Well, I would say that in the end, the Chinese will be very pragmatic. So for now, they might play to the rules. They might reduce their Iranian imports. But in the end, if prices move too high, moving towards 80 or above 80 or towards 85 even, then the willingness to play to the US rules, especially in China, might be less, and they might be starting again to import some
oil. So where do you see the support and resistance levels right now in the oil market?
Let's say from a purely fundamental point of view, we think the fair price range is between 50 and 70. So we are above that range. As I said, sentiment is bullish and that might prolong this rally a little bit. But let's put it this way, the higher prices go, the more likely a decline is subsequently.
Let's talk about the crude futures as well, and they're up some 40% so far this year. Is this also valid for crude futures, the rise in prices?
Well, the further out you go along the futures curve, the less the price increases, because we are talking, as you said, about supply disruptions, and usually the most prominent impact of these supply disruptions is at the front end of the futures curve or in the spot market. So the price increase has not been as prominent further out into the future.
And of course, all of this has also an impact on other markets, especially palladium, right? What are you seeing there? What kind of movements?
Well, the palladium story is very much tied to the global car markets, of course. So the more cars are being sold, the more gasoline cars are being sold, the more palladium is needed in the catalysts. And I mean, this has been something in the past, together with the shift away from diesel-fueled cars in Europe, which has been fueling this palladium price rally.
And this brings us to the next topic of car sales. And the 2019 Motor Show in Shanghai has just concluded yesterday. We have seen lackluster demand from buyers and also from the audience. A reporter I spoke to in Shanghai actually said she's never seen such a slow and, you know, low demand Motor Show in Shanghai. What's happening there?
Well, that mirrors the current state of the Chinese car market, where we've been seeing sales down for like 9 or 10 months down in a row, and this is very, very unusual for the Chinese market.
It is very sluggish. The CAAM, the Chinese Auto Manufacturing Association, has warned this might continue. We have seen, as you mentioned, car sales drop to the lowest level in 9 months, but this is painting a global picture, isn't it?
Well, there is a global dent in car sales. I mean, Europe is also down a little bit. The US is stagnating. We have other emerging markets which are sluggish or slowing, but in China it is really excessive. And it is, well, basically based on three factors. So, I mean, obviously the economy has been weak. That is not supportive. But more importantly, from my point of view, this is a payback for a tax-driven boom we had in the previous years. And it is also a consequence of a crackdown on car financing, on shadow banking.
But still, we are seeing in this part of the world here, for example, German car makers suffering as well.
Well, they do, because they export a lot of their cars to China. I mean, if you look at the European car markets, they are slightly below the zero line. So not a very compelling, not a very positive backdrop for the car makers, but clearly manageable. But if you have like minus 15% in China, that hurts.
We had, for example, Daimler reporting that the operating revenue, the operating profit fell 16% today. Do you see this kind of low, bad performance continue for the German car makers? Or is it a one-quarter effect?
Well, I would say that the Chinese car market should gradually improve this year. It is very, very likely that the full year will be negative, which is very unusual for China. And, well, depending on how this planned stimulus program is playing out, it's just a question of whether the cars are being bought today or sometime later, right? Because these stimulus programs in the past, they've never created additional demand. It's just about pulling demand from the future into the present.
Now, if the global car industry is not performing so well, what will it mean for the Swiss car suppliers here in the country?
Well, in the end, if fewer cars are being sold, you need fewer parts, and that then also does not bode very well for the supplier industry, of course.